येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ॐ विष्णुपादाय कृष्णपृष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिन्निति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम राम हरे हरे। हरे कृष्णा। So it's a very beautiful verse that we are reading today on the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam. Asti eva me sarvam idam tvayuktam. Vyasa uvacha. Asti eva me sarvam idam tvayuktam. Tathapi natma paritushyate me. Tanmoolam avyaktam agadha bodham. Prichha mahe tvatma bhavatma bhutam. So interestingly, this is Vyasadeva speaking first time after we've been waiting and anticipating. Now that Narad Muni has come and he has also started speaking, in response to Narad Muni's speaking, this is the first verse spoken by Vyasa. Vyasa Vacha. So the great learned scholar Vyasadeva is now beginning to speak. What is he speaking? Asti eva me sarvam idam tvayoktam. Whatever you have told about me is all true. So what he has told, we will see that a little bit in the previous verses. Narad Muni has used certain adjectives and he has described Vyasadeva in certain ways. So Vyasadeva is acknowledging, asti eva me sarvam idam tvayoktam. Whatever you have told about me is all true. Tathapi natma paritushyate me. Tathapi natma paritushyate me. Still I am not satisfied within me. Tan moolam avyaktam agadha bodham. So he is addressing Narad Muni with certain adjectives here. Avyaktam agadha bodham. You are a man of unlimited knowledge. So if you see the first canto in the fifth chapter, Narad Muni, when he begins to address Vyasadeva, he uses a word parasarya. I was in the verse Parasarya Mahabhaga Bhavata Kachidatmana Paritushyati Sarira Atma Manasa Evava. First canto, fifth chapter, second verse. Parasarya, Narad Muni was reminding Vyasadeva of his lineage, that he is a son of Parasara Rishi. Parasarya Mahabhaga, very fortunate. Bhavata kachidatmana paritushyati. Why you are not satisfied? Why are you despondent? You're coming from such a high lineage, such a nice parent you had. So how is it that you are not satisfied? Bhavata kachidatmana paritushyati sarira atma manasa eva. And in response to this, when Vyasadeva begins to speak, he is telling, well, I may be just Parasarya, I'm the son of Parasar, but you are Tvatma Bhavatma Bhutam. You are actually the son of self-born Brahma. Atma Bhava, Atma Bhutam. Atma Bhutam means your son or your offspring. Of whom? Of Atma Bhava. Atma Bhava is Brahma, who is self-born, who didn't have a material father and mother. Prichamahe Tvam. So now Tanmulam, I am actually asking you, because you are also extremely learned and knowledgeable, because you are born to that father who is self-born. Brahma, you being the son of Brahma, who have got agadha bodham, who has got unlimited knowledge, tan moolam, I am asking you, what is the root cause of this despondency? Tan moolam prichamahe. Very interestingly, the word here used, one more word, is avyaktam. Avyaktam is, this is undetected. So the translation is, Sri Vyasadeva said, all you have said about me is perfectly correct. Despite all this, I am not pacified. I therefore question you about the root cause of my dissatisfaction. For you are a man of unlimited knowledge due to your being the offspring of one who is self-born. Since you are the son of Brahma, you are a man of unlimited knowledge. So you can actually tell me the root cause of my dissatisfaction. So it's been some time that, you know, we've been hearing this and we've been seeing this appearance of Narada and Narada's instruction on Srimad Bhagavatam. Just to set the context right where we are in Bhagavatam, in this wonderful discussion, especially this chapter is a very important chapter because it reveals some of the things which all of us individually in our life also go through. We may have so much of knowledge, like Vyasadeva is, he's erudite scholar, he's the compiler of all the Vedic literatures, yet he can feel despondent. So it has a lot of practical relevance for all of us in our life also. But just to remind the context of what's going on in Bhagavatam, this is actually, the setting is Naimisharanya, where the assembled sages have asked the six questions to Suta Goswami, and Suta Goswami has finished answering the six questions. And we saw in the fourth chapter of Srimad Bhagavatam, they asked further three more questions. How did Bhagavatam come about? How did this entire Bhagavatam come about? What is the reason for Bhagavatam to come about? Tell us about the great personality called Parikshit Maharaj, his activities. Tell us about Sukadev Goswami, who narrated Bhagavatam to Parikshit. How did they meet? So these were the three questions which the sages further asked after those initial six questions asked to Suta Goswami. And then whatever he answers, Suta Goswami, that becomes the subject matter from the fourth chapter onwards till the 19th chapter of Bhagavatam first canto. So in response to these questions asked by the sages, these additional questions, Suta Goswami begins to answer about how did Bhagavatam come about, and he talks about the despondency of Vedavyas. Vedavyas, who is the great learned scholar, by his mystic power, by his position, by his scholarship, by his knowledge, could see that actually the time which is going to come is a very, very difficult time. He says, Paravaragya Sarishi Kalena Avyaktaramhasa Yuga Dharma Vyatikrama Praptam Bhuvi Yuge Yuge. So Vedavyas could see the anomalies in the coming time, in the millennium. And so there's a Kali Yuga which is going to come. So what he did was he put all this knowledge which was available in writing. Then he divided the Vedas into four and he assigned different professors, as Prabhupada says, as the custodian of knowledge of this four Vedas. Then he further wrote Mahabharata for the less intelligent class of people. So he did a very diligent work out of great compassion, seeing that there is going to be anomalies, there is going to be a lot of discrepancies, there is going to be a lot of problems in the future because of his vision, because of his knowledge, because of his realization. He could see that, so he put it in writing. He not only just put it in writing, he divided the Vedas. He wrote even further literatures which will help people who are less intelligent so that they can advance in their spiritual life. Yet, Vedavyas was not satisfied. And that is also mentioned in the first canto, fourth chapter, 31st verse, where he's saying, Kimba Bhagavata Dharma na prayena nirupitaha priyaha paramahamsanam taeva hi achyuta priyaha. So he's telling, maybe I did not specifically point out to devotional service of the Lord, which is dear both to the perfect beings and the infallible Lord. Priyaha paramahamsanam. It is dear. Devotional service is not just dear to paramahamsanam, who are greatest Vaishnavas or devotees. It is also achyuta priya. It is also very dear to the Supreme Lord himself. Since I specifically didn't describe about that, Maybe that is the cause of my despondency. So when he's going through, when he's reflecting, when he's meditating, what could be the reason, what's going on? At that point in time, Narad Muni appears there. And Narad Muni begins to speak, and he speaks in a little sarcastic way, where he says that verse that I read, Parasarya Mahabhaga Bhavatah Kachidatmana Paritushyati Sarira Atma Manasa Evava. So Vyasadev, he was addressed by Narada, oh, you are, you know, son of Parasar, you are such a great fortunate person. So, but then Paritushyati Sarira, are you satisfied by identifying with the body or the mind as objects of self-realization? That was the first question, the first inquiry by Narad Muni. Then somebody might think that maybe Vyasadeva was ignorant, he didn't know. But that Narad Muni clarifies in the next two verses where he says, no, you are actually competent. You have all the knowledge. He's saying, Jigyasitam susampannam apite mahadadbhutam kritavan bharatam yastvam sarvartha paribrahmitam. Your inquiries are full and your studies were also fully, were well fulfilled. And there is no doubt that you have prepared a great and wonderful work. That is the Mahabharata, which is full of all kinds of Vedic sequences elaborately explained. It is not that Vedavyas was not aware or he was ignorant. And then he goes on to talk about, you have fully delineated the subject of impersonal Brahman as well as the knowledge derived therefrom. In spite of all this, why should you be despondent, thinking that you are undone, my dear Prabhu? So he's addressing very nicely, my dear Prabhu. And then this verse today that we are taking, which is Vyasa Vacha, the first verse which Vyasadeva has spoken. In this verse, actually, there is a lot of things to learn, especially how do we deal with our spiritual master? Because this is the first verse which which Vedavyas is telling. I remember I was interacting with one psychiatrist. MIT has got this people who are suffering from some depression and those kind of things, they have got some counselors, psychiatrists who give help. So that person was telling, actually, half of the problem will be over if the patient acknowledges that he has a problem. The sessions that they have, mostly it is, you know, to tell the person that you have some problem and you need help. Even in our lives also, if we acknowledge that we are in problem, we are in some kind of a difficulty, I need help, then the solution given or the treatment given is very effective. It, tack, 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 it'll work. But then the challenge is the resistance in acknowledging or accepting that I have a problem. But here we can see from the example of Vyasadeva, he's saying, all you have said about me is perfectly correct. He acknowledges that, yes, there is some problem within me. There is something which is lacking. I'm not pacified. And how does he address his spiritual master with so much of reverence, with so much of respect, with so much of submission? I therefore question you about the root cause of my dissatisfaction, for you are a man of unlimited knowledge. If we go with a challenging or with a questioning attitude, or with an attitude that I know everything, I just want to confirm with you, that is, actually the knowledge doesn't come. If you remember in Bhagavad Gita, there is a very beautiful verse which comes about Samadarshi. Anybody knows which verse is that? No. What is the first one? Vidya? You're only saying, okay. Chopaka nahi hai. You are there, but you are Vidya Vinaya Sampanne Brahmane Gavi Hastini Suni Chena Swapakecha Panditaha Samadarshana. Interesting thing is, if you see that verse, the first line itself is Vidya Vinaya. Only knowledge is not enough. So Vedavyas, even though he had so much of knowledge and he wrote so many things, yet that humility is also required. Vidya Vinaya Sampanne. Without that humility, the knowledge from the spiritual master doesn't come. And we will see in the subsequent verses, even Vedavyas, when he speaks, when he's asking questions to Narada Muni, what is the mood in which he's asking? Vidya Vinaya. So it's a very important thing when we are approaching the spiritual master, the mood of approaching should be of humble submission. Yes, and acknowledging, yes, I have this problem. I have got these issues. I'm opening my heart. I'm expressing this and I want some solution for this. Now, if you see in the purport, and we have the title of this today's session is The Root Cause of Despondency. The first thing that I want you to highlight, to see from this purport, very short purport, but very interesting, very instructive, which Prabhupada is saying, that this is not always detected. So make a note that the root cause of our despondencies is not always detected. So you may say, maybe I don't have the knowledge, or maybe, you know, I'm not well equipped. That's why I'm not able to detect myself. Wrong. Because Prabhupada is writing in the purport, the line is, this is not always detected, even though one may be the greatest erudite scholar in materialistic knowledge. One may have PhD, one may have postdoc, one may have double PhD. Materially, very, very qualified, lot of knowledge. Materially, one person is extremely knowledgeable. Still, it is difficult to detect. This is not always detected, even though one may be the greatest erudite scholar in materialistic knowledge. What is the root cause of despondency? That is mentioned in the previous line. As such, all knowledge disseminated in the material world is related either with the body or with the mind. And that is the root cause of all despondencies. So this needs to be understood. We have knowledge in material world. There's a varieties of bodies of knowledge available. But what Prabhupada is saying, as such, all knowledge disseminated in the material world is related either with the body or with the mind. And since it is related either with the body or the mind, that is the root cause of all despondencies. And if you see the first line, we are going in a reverse order, but that makes more logical this thing. In the material world, everyone is engrossed with the idea of identifying the body or the mind as the self. Everyone is engrossed with the idea of identifying the body or the mind with the self. And as such, all knowledge disseminated in the material world is related either with the body or with the mind, and that is the root cause of all despondencies. I want you to just remember something which we have finished reading in our discussions of Srimad Bhagavatam. There was one line which comes in the first canto, third chapter, 33rd verse, 1333. In that purport, actually, Prabhupada writes, self-realization means becoming indifferent to the needs of the gross and subtle bodies and becoming serious about the activities of the self. So there are needs of the gross and subtle bodies. Gross body, which is made up of these five gross elements, which is our external covering, and the subtle body, which is made up of mind, intelligence, and false ego. There is a need. But Prabhupada is writing, self-realization means becoming indifferent to the needs of the gross and subtle bodies and becoming serious about the activities of the self. This is what self-realization means. Now look at our position. Bhagavatam mentions in the first canto, first chapter, 10th verse, Prayana Alpayusa Sabhya Kalo Asmin Yuge Janaha. Manda samanda matayo, manda bhagya hi upadrita. And in that, there is another verse which comes, the line, apannah samsritim ghoram. And if you see the translation of that, Prabhupada says, we are stuck in a complicated mess of birth and death. Apannah samsritim ghoram. It's a very scary existence. Even small little things becomes very difficult. For that matter, you know, there are some people who don't even get sleep in the night. Just sleep also doesn't come. Or even doing some simple activities like maybe, you know, earning livelihood or working in a company and prospering and taking care of the families. These are all very, very complicated. Apannaha samsritim ghoram. That's why it's a complicated mess of birth and death. You can countlessly, there are so many examples that we see, but we don't see them. We don't really realize, we don't look at them very closely. But it is, you know, mind is disturbed, body is disturbed. Mind says something, body says something, gives excuses. Intelligence follows because intelligence is also not strong. And when this happens, this tussle, this mind intelligence, trying to justify the actions that we want to do, we get diverted from spiritual activities. If you remember in the third chapter of Bhagavad Gita, where Krishna gives a hierarchy of the self, first he talks about the senses being the outlets by which we do all our activities, which is superior to the dull matter. Superior to the senses is our mind. Superior to the mind is our intelligence. And superior to intelligence is our false ego. Superior to false ego is the self, the soul, spirit soul. Now, when somebody is trying to understand the knowledge of the self, which is beyond matter, which is beyond mind and intelligence, what is happening is we are trying to use our logical thinking, our intelligence, to talk about self, which is superior even to our false ego. So there is one fallacy in this, is with our intelligence to overcome the false ego is not possible, because intelligence is subservient to false ego. So when we try to rationally think and find out how am I not this body? How is it eternal? How it is different from body and mind? You cannot figure it out because your intelligence is subservient to the false ego, and false ego is very deep, very strong. I am man, I am woman, I am mother, I am father, I am husband, I am wife, I am son, I am daughter, I am brother, I am sister, I am Indian, I am American. This false ego is very, very strong. So that's where, as this verse says, that one needs to approach a self-realized person like Narada Muni, who can tell, who can reveal this, and just accept it. These are not some ordinary people who are roaming around here and there, and they have, we meet so many people in our life, so they are also one of them. No, they are self-realized souls, and they can tell us which. If we just follow those instructions, we can understand our position very well. We can understand what's going on. Now, to explain this, we will take three verses from Bhagavatam, and these are very wonderful verses. The verse that I just spoke here, 1.3.33, self-realization means becoming indifferent to the needs of the gross and subtle bodies and becoming serious about the activities of the self. This verse is a wonderful verse because it is saying becoming indifferent to the needs of the gross and subtle bodies. Is it easy to becoming indifferent? How do we become indifferent to the gross and subtle bodies' needs? Sometimes we want to do some sadhana, but little mind gives a little excuse and we are away. Or there is one simple, some inspiration has come, let me do something for Krishna. But there is something else which comes up, and then we think, no, it is not worth it. It is not. We'll postpone this. We will do it in some other time. But how do we become indifferent to the needs of the gross and subtle bodies and become serious about the activities of the self? Because there lies the clue. So let's see this verse, which is 1.3.33. Let me just show that verse. So in this verse, if you see, the translation is, whenever a person experiences by self-realization that both the gross and subtle bodies have nothing to do with the pure self, at that time he sees himself as well as the Lord. So self-realization is not just understanding the self, it is also seeing the Lord. Seeing the Lord, I mean, our position is not independent. Our position is always in relationship with the Lord. So self-realization means seeing ourselves in relationship to the Lord. And it's a very interesting purport because, you know, the way Prabhupada explains some of the things is actually very, very interesting. And he brings this contrast of people who are living in this material world. There are two ways of living in this material world. One is an illusory way of living. There is something called material illusion. And there is another way, which is living the life of self-realization. And he begins to say that the difference between self-realization and material illusion is to know that the temporary or illusory impositions of material energy in the shape of gross and subtle bodies are superficial coverings of the self. It's a loaded sentence, but you have to. So the difference between self-realization and illusion. People ask, no, what is self-realization? And what does Maya mean? What is the difference between these two? Both are, you know, the living entities are subservient to either to, you know, material illusion, the external energy of the Lord, or he is in self-realization. The difference is to know that the temporary or illusory impositions of the material energy, there is an imposition of material energy in the form of this gross and subtle bodies. These are superficial coverings of the self. They are not me. This is the difference. You know, one can live a life of illusion, thinking I am this body, working in that direction, because we are all driven by certain things. We are driven by the fact that I am such and such. And that is based on the identification of the body. Or I am driven by the fact that I am a spirit soul, have got nothing to do with the superficial coverings. The coverings take place due to ignorance. Such coverings are never effective in the person of the personality of Godhead. Knowing this convincingly is called liberation, or seeing the absolute. This means that perfect self-realization is made possible by adoption of godly or spiritual life. Spiritual life. Self-realization means becoming indifferent to the needs of gross and subtle bodies and becoming serious about the activities of the self, which I spoke about. The impetus for activities is generated from the self, but such activities become illusory due to ignorance of the real position of the self. This is a very important thing. Impetus for the activities is generated from the self. We want to be happy. The definition of happiness is by pleasing our body, mind, and senses. Because we identify ourselves with the body, at the most, mind or intelligence. But this impetus, but such activities become illusory due to the ignorance of the real position of the self. By ignorance, self-interest is calculated in terms of the gross and subtle bodies, and therefore a whole set of activities is spoiled, life after life. When, however, one meets the self by proper culture, the activities of the self begin. Therefore, a man who is engaged in the activities of the self is called Jivan Mukta, or a liberated person, even in the conditional existence. Prabhupada is referring to this verse, Iha yasya harer dase nikilasu api avasthasu, Jivan Mukta Sauchyate. Iha yasya harer dase manasa kayana manasa gira. What is that verse? Search that verse. Nikilasu api avasthasu Jivan Mukta Sauchyate. Even remaining in this material world, Iha yasya harer dase, who's engaging by his mind, body, and words, kayana manasa vacha. He becomes free from the temporary impositions of this material energy. He becomes Jivan Mukta. Now, we have heard this many times, right? How we are not this body, we are spirit soul. But then the identification is so strong or the illusory coverings are so overwhelming, so powerful, that it is very difficult to come out of this. There are two verses in Bhagavatam which I personally like a lot, which talks about how does this misconception come about in our life, how do we perceive them, and what we should do so that we can come out of them. They are there in Bhagavatam 3.7.11 and 3.7.12, these two verses. So this verse 3.7.11, did you get? Yes, you heard it. What is the next line, second line? Karmana Manasa Gira. So by activities, Manasa and Gira. By Gira is words? Translation?
Body, mind, intelligence,
and words. Body, mind, intelligence, and words. So let us just pay attention to this verse in 3rd Canto, 7th chapter, 11th verse, where actually there is a beautiful way this is explained, how we misidentify ourselves with this material world and how we can come out. That is given in the next verse. It's a very interesting verse. Yatha jale chandramasaha kampadistat krito gunaha drishyate san api drashtur atmanu natmanu gunaha. The translation is, as the moon reflected on water appears to the seer to tremble due to being associated with the quality of the water, so the self associated with matter appears to be qualified as matter. It's a very beautiful verse. You know, if you just see, Bhagavatam reveals these things, and our acharyas have commented on this very wonderfully. Where is the moon? Moon is located in the sky. Moon is located in the sky, but the reflection of moon is falling in the water. And if there is a disturbance in the water, if the water is trembling due to some things, then it appears as if the moon is also trembling. Because the water is trembling, the moon is appearing to be trembling over there. So the verse is telling, as the moon reflected on water appears to seer, somebody who's seeing that, to tremble due to being associated with the quality of the water, so the self associated with matter appears to be qualified as matter. Sometimes, because we identify ourselves with the body, we think all the pains, the miseries, the praises, the happiness, the sorrow, all these things are related to my soul. I'm so affected. So the self associated with the matter appears to be qualified as matter. So the self is identifying himself with the matter, like the, you know, seer seeing that the moon is trembling in the water. Actually, the moon is not trembling. The spirit soul has got nothing to do with this. But because of this, so the self associated with matter appears to be qualified as matter. We understand the problem, but how do we come out? How should I come out of this bodily concept of life? Actually, Krishna, in the Bhagavatam, the next verse, it is explained. Savai nivritti dharmena vasudevanu kampaya bhagavat bhakti yogena tirtho dhate sanairiha. Sanairiha. Sanai is gradual. Very interesting verse. Translation is, but that misconception of the self-identity can be diminished gradually by the mercy of the personality of Godhead. By Vasudevanu Kampaya, Anukampa. By the mercy of the personality of Godhead. How? Through the process of devotional service to the Lord in the mode of detachment. Tirtho dhate saner iha. Sane, gradually. If you remember in 15th chapter also, Krishna says, Matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha. From me comes the remembrance. From me also comes the forgetfulness. Somebody wants to be forgetful of his own self, can remain engaged in the material activities forever. Because the Lord inspires, you know, if Matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha. Vedescha sarver ahameva vedyam. So that misconception of self-identity can be diminished gradually, sanehi, by the mercy of the personality of Godhead, Vasudeva. through the process of devotional service to the Lord in the mode of detachment. Actually, the process of devotional service is so vital, so important for us. The process of devotional service has to be done in the proper way, not as I am the knower of this service. Without me, this service will not happen. I'll keep some things with me, and I'll not. No, as a servant, because this devotional service is going to purify me. It's not that I'm doing some favor on someone. But this is for my own purification. Wherever there is material dissension, there is quarrel, or there is this some kind of disagreement, that means there is some material concept. As Kunti Maharani says, that Vitoh Kali. Whenever Krishna is missing in the center of activities, then it brings dissension, quarrel, and disagreement. But the process of devotional service as a means by which I purify myself, as a means by which I can come out of this coverings, that misconception of self-identity can be diminished gradually by the mercy of the personality of Godhead, Vasudev, through the process of devotional service to the Lord in the mode of detachment. And these are very wonderful purports to see and understand. I don't want to read, but I just read this 3.7.11, 3.7.12. How does one get caught up in this misidentification of the self, and how does one come out of this? Just to follow up with what we spoke so far, in conclusion, actually there is, our scriptures have, you know, time and again have explained these things very wonderfully. Wonderful examples are there. Wonderful illustrations are there, and this knowledge is shared, and this is elaborated by Srila Prabhupada for our benefits. One last thing, actually, which I wanted to tell is, there is this wonderful chapter in Srimad Bhagavatam. I recommend that even if you have not read the entire Bhagavatam, look for this chapter in the fifth canto, which says the forest of material enjoyment. The title of the chapter itself is Forest of Material Enjoyment. And in that chapter, it is actually an instruction given by Jada Bharat to King Rahugana. Rahugana was so deeply rooted in that bodily concept of life. I am the king. I am the emperor. Everybody should serve me. I've got a lot of power. I've got a lot of money. And since I am the king, everybody should bow down, should offer his respects. In that connection, Jada Bharat, you know, talks about the forest of material enjoyment. And in that chapter, very interestingly, it is mentioned when a person is not satisfied with what he has in terms of his material possessions and material things in life, when he's not satisfied, that he seeks, he looks for more happiness, more possessions, and more whatever those, you know, indulgence. So he enters into this forest of material enjoyment. The root cause is somebody who's not satisfied, and there is a greed in the heart to have more, that he enters into that material forest of enjoyment. And very interestingly, when somebody enters into that material forest of enjoyment, little does he know that there are jackals, there are dacoits, there are vultures, there are so many other, you know, living entities who are ready to attack and pounce on him. He may be able to collect some very valuable minerals and jewels and stuff like that, but he gets plundered. So Bhagavatam, actually the instruction which Rahugana gives in Bhagavatam to Jada Bharat is, he's telling that these plunderers are not anybody else but our own mind and senses. They take away our time, the valuable time that we have. They take away our valuable human energy that we have. They sap us up out of those vitality. Because we're looking for more, and they just plunder us. We don't even realize that, you know, we are meant to serve the Lord, even if we have heard, understood, and we get completely diverted. not just our mind and senses. The primary things are mind and senses, because there are vultures, there are dacoits, there are wild animals. So it refers to even our family members, relatives and friends and all these people. They take away all our, you know, possessions, that purusartha. And one remains in that bodily concept of life and forgets that the real cause of despondency is identifying oneself with this body and mind. It is only when one engages in devotional service to Krishna, savai pumsam, paro dharmo yato bhakti radhokshaje ahetuki apratihata ye atma su prasidati. If we engage in devotional service without any motives, ahetuki, no cause, savai pumsam paro dharmo yato bhakti radhokshaje ahetuki apratihata, uninterruptedly. Not today, and then again after 7 days on Sunday at 10 o'clock, I'll be shown. I'll be seen. Apratihata. Or after a month, after next Janmashtami or something like that. Apratihata. Ye atma su prasidati. Completely satisfies. So these are some of the points from this wonderful verse. This chapter itself is very important, because this chapter reveals the root cause of despondency, and we will see how Vedavyas speaks his mind, opens his mind, and Narad Muni pinpoints. He says exactly why you are not satisfied. And that reason is so apt, because in our life, we also consider ourselves to be very intelligent. Nobody considers himself to be a fool. We consider we know everything. And yet, like, you know, it is mentioned in this purport that this remains undetected. It is not easy to detect this. So that is why you need the help of a spiritual master who's free from the clutches of this material energy to point out. And very interestingly, when Narad Muni begins to speak, he chastises. You need someone who, you need the words of Guru. That not everybody should pacify you, should tell you, oh, you are so good, you are nice, you are great, you are wonderful. No, factually, somebody has to give that feedback for our benefits to understand and apply it in our life. Jugupsitam, he says, this is condemnable. Whatever you have done, this work, to that extent, you know, this such a wonderful work is done, but he says this is absolutely condemned. And then he reveals something that we will see in the next verses. I'll stop here and see if you have any questions or comments. Tana, since you are attending for the first time, I would like to hear any feedback, any comment. You can write if you're not able to speak. Different bodies and would love to understand more how to connect to self. Actually, since you are interested in the philosophy of Hinduism, one of the very fundamental core aspect of our philosophy is we are eternal. Eternality means we have existence beyond our birth and death. That is what is the beginning instruction which Krishna gives to Arjuna. Very poetic. Natve vaham jatu nasam natvam neme janadipa nachaiva na bhavishyama sarve vayam atah param. 2.12 in Bhagavad Gita. So the time has the three phases of existence, past, present and future. And Krishna is telling in three persons, first person, second person and third person, me, you and all these kings. There was never a time in the past, and right now anyway we are all present, and there will never be a time in future when we will not cease to exist, and when we will not exist. That means we will always be present, but we know that our body has a beginning and an end. So how Krishna is telling that, you know, we are always present, that eternality of that spiritual energy or that thing which is there beyond our body and matter is called Atman or Self, which is non-perishable. And that thing is mentioned in the next verse itself also. Dehinosmin yatha dehe komaram yovanam jara tatha dehantara praptir dhiras tatrana mushyati. So there is a dehi and there is a deha, the body and the owner or the possessor of the body. The owner or the possessor of the body changes, transmigrates bodies in this very life itself. Reincarnation doesn't happen only when we die, we accept another body. It does happen at that time, but we do accept bodies in this very life. We change our bodies. Everybody goes through this. Sharing this example, and I've been just sharing this. When I was 7 or 8 years old, I don't remember exactly, 7 or 8 maybe, I was playing cricket and the ball hit me on my tooth and it got broken. And now that, you know, I don't have that body, my teeth is also there, body is changed, but I remember that I had that experience. I remember that I had that thing, you know, the ball hit me. Who is that I? That body is changed. That tooth which was broken has grown up. Everything has changed, but how do I remember? Who's that I who's able to remember? Krishna says that I is actually that spirit self, Atman. And he goes on to explain that in subsequent verses. And that's the beginning of understanding of who we are. And not just that, transcendental knowledge is always in relationship with Krishna. And in 15th chapter, Krishna says, Mamevamso jiva loke jiva bhuta sanatanaha. Mana shashtani indriyani prakriti sthani karsati. There also the word sanatana is used. We are eternally part and parcel of the Lord. Like sunshine, which is always part of the sun. We are eternally part and parcel of the Lord. Mana shashtani indriyani prakriti sthani karsati. Because of our the senses and identifying ourselves with this body and matter, we are karsati. We are going through this tough material existence. We are struggling in this material world. Higher self and physical self, I believe you gave them names, and perhaps there are more than two categories to break them into. So basically what Krishna says, yeah, you have to refer to 7.5 and 7.6, where he's telling, Bhumirapo analavayu kham manabuddhirevacha ahankara iti amme bhinna prakritir ashtadha. There are these eight elements which are matter, which are the coverings. So I told about the self being covered with a gross covering, which is made up of this earth, water, air, fire, earth, water, air, fire, and ether. Bhumi, apo, anala, vayu, kham. Five things. That is a gross body. And the subtle body, subtle means it's not, it cannot be perceived, is made up of manabuddhi, bhumi, apo, anala, vayu, kham, manabuddhi, revacha, ahankara. So manabuddhi and ahankara. Ahankara is the false ego, mind, intelligence, and false ego. That's our subtle body. These are the two coverings on the soul. They're made up of many versions of ourselves. So these. So we identify ourselves with the body. I'm this body. This is what I am. I see myself always in the mirror, and I see how I can enjoy with this body. At the most, sometimes we go to mind level. Oh, maybe I'm not this body because I'm distinct from mind, my body. Sometimes I'm happy, distressed. We go to that level. But Krishna is telling these are all the coverings of the real self. Self is covered by these two coverings, subtle body and the gross body. I hope that helps, Sana. Any other question? Devotional service in the mode of detachment is sometimes we do devotional service with some motives to get praised, to be known, to be seen. That's not devotional service. Devotional service is just being engaged in the service of the Lord without any motive, anything that comes, whatever it is. It's a great fortune that I'm getting this opportunity to serve. So let me serve as a servant. Let me serve to purify myself, because it's funny, gradually one will come out of that misconception of the self. If you read the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, where Kapila Muni is instructing Devahuti, so he is addressing their devotional service in the mode of passion, in the mode of ignorance, and in the mode of goodness. So it is good to know this. It is elaborately explained there. Any other questions? Any other thoughts? Since it's a different set of audience, I don't see Jadati, I don't see Shyamji, Sana, and other sessions that we have. I just wanted to tell you that next week on Saturday, we have the overview of Bhagavad Gita in 3 hours. That's at 9 o'clock. And let me show that if I can. Let me share my screen. This is on Saturday, yeah. As humanity is going through a tough phase, everyone is looking for solace, not only on financial matters, but also about peace of mind. Why life is so relentless? What's the purpose of life? This tough phase, taking a toll on the physical as well as mental health. The whole world is now looking at India's spiritual wisdom. We as Indians generally don't give much importance to our ancient knowledge, which Western countries and many other countries putting efforts to get in depth insights and imbibing this great knowledge which our ancient sages rendered easily. The world needs to turn towards real knowledge given by Lord Krishna to Arjuna in Bhagavad Gita. Resolutions to all kinds of problems encountered by each individual, whether rich or poor, big or small, elderly or adolescent, from any background, gender, caste, creed, religion, or color are included in Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita shows the path to the lost, answer to the baffled, and wisdom to all. For this session, followed by that we will have a wonderful course on glorious Srila Prabhupada. Very, very important personality to know what is his mission, what he did, what is his contribution, who he is, and what is our relationship with Srila Prabhupada. And that we will have in 3 weeks time. Sure, Sana, we will do something. We'll do that. We will deliver to you the recordings now. If no other questions, then we'll stop here. The Granthra Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Nitai Gaur Premanande. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.